This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. Thee you would take my place. Thee you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. Then I would be set free. Whoa.
Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to our Dare to Dream Worship Day 2021. We cannot express to you this morning how happy and excited we are to finally be in this beautiful sanctuary here in Mossvale Community Church to bring you this worship day. Your two wonderful speakers are here, our Mossvale Praise and Worship Band are here that we know you've all come to know and love. And your two hosts are here. I am Susan, and I'll be leading you through this morning. And you'll see Mary shortly. That's not her full name, but she is a gorgeous wee soul. We are all here. The only people missing are you, beautiful daughters of the King. And we miss you all so, so much. But we know you are just as excited as we are today at home, ready to praise and worship the King and have the best day ever praising his name together. And if it is your first time at a Woman2Woman event, we just want to pray an extra special blessing on you this morning and thank you for being with us today. We just pray you will be mightily, mightily blessed. Before I say anything else, ladies, let's just give this day over to our Lord in prayer. Let's just come before the Lord and pray. Dear Lord, we do just thank you for the Dare to Dream Worship Day, and we thank you that we are finally here, Lord. We just pray a blessing over this whole day, that hearts will be touched, that you will just show your love to all the ladies watching at home, Lord. We pray a blessing over our speakers today. The praise and worship, may it be acceptable to you, dear Lord. May your Holy Spirit move in a wonderful, fresh way amongst us all today. Thank you for Dare to Dream. Thank you for the platform that we are using this morning, Lord Jesus. In your name we pray, amen and amen. So, if you've been to one of our Woman2Woman events before, you will know that at this point, I usually do my wee cabin crew bit, and I direct you to where you can go to the fire exits and where you can have your food and a coffee at lunchtime with your friends and have a chat. But you're all at home in your houses, so you know where your kettle is and you know where your loo is, so we're all good there. So let me first begin by asking you a question. Let me warm you up a little bit this morning. Do you believe in dreams? What are your dreams? Let that sink in for a little bit. You might want to write it down in your gorgeous wee book that you got in your pack. You might want to share it with a family member if you're watching alongside one of them, or maybe not. That's entirely up to you. Your dream might be a certain job or career, or maybe to live in a new place, visit an exotic country that fascinates you. Or maybe it's an experience. Do you want to jump out a plane or something crazy? Do you want to abseil down the side of a mountain? Or perhaps it's something else. To find love, to be happy, to be brave. Is that your dream today? There are so, so many things we can dream. Our worship day this year is called Dare to Dream. And let me read this beautiful quote to you this morning, ladies, by Eleanor Roosevelt. It says, "The future belongs to those who believe in the beauty of their dreams." How beautiful is that? The future belongs to those who believe in the beauty of their dreams. Today, ladies, you'll be brought God's word by our two amazing speakers, Pastor Debbie Orr and Pastor Hugh Chalk, are both serving pastors here in Mossvale Community Church. And I cannot wait to hear what God has for us all today with this beautiful theme of daring to dream in our minds. Pastor Debbie will be bringing God's word this morning and after a time of praise and worship by our amazing worship team led by Peter Chalk. But at this point, ladies, I want to talk to you about something very important, about prayer. At Woman2Woman, prayer is always an integral, vital part of all we do in this ministry. And just because we cannot physically be together does not mean we can't offer the opportunity to pray with you. So what we plan to do today is to offer prayer support sessions at the lunch break and again after the event. On screen now, I've always wanted to do that, you should see a contact number, and you may already have seen the number with your lovely little sheet that was sent out to you in your welcome pack. Now, what we want you to do, ladies, is should you require prayer, we want you to text the number that's on the screen and give your name. You do not have to list what you require prayer for at this point. The important thing is you request prayer and you leave your name. That is the most important part. At Woman2Woman, many of you who've come along to our sessions will know we have a dedicated prayer ministry who are here to offer support. And today is no different. So I hope that encourages you already. Now, ladies, it's time to properly kick off our worship day in the usual fashion by inviting our Mossvale worship team to lead us in a time of praise. Let me just read Psalm 100 to you. It says, "Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is good. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise, and give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good, and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations." Amen and amen. Ladies, get ready. Clear a space in your lounge so you can be free to express yourself this morning. Get ready to praise and worship him. Open your heart to Jesus today. It is my honour to welcome the Mossvale Community Church worship team.
Feel free to stand and worship with us wherever you are today.
Battle, you seem a victory.
And all I see is the mountains. You see a mountain move. And as I walk through the shadows, your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear now, for I am safe.
I'm gonna see your victory. turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good.
You take the enemy back.
thank you so much to our amazing worship team, and you will hear much more from them in this afternoon's session. Now, ladies, it is my privilege to introduce our first speaker of the day, Pastor Debbie Orr. Debbie is a pastor here at Mossvale Community Church in Renfrewshire. She is a wife, a mother, and a passionate follower of Jesus. She has a real passion also for women's ministry and founded the first Woman2Woman group in Glasgow in Scotland in 2006. Her heart's desire is to see women set free to fulfill God's purpose in their lives. She had a desire to bring a message of freedom today that enables God's children to know the truth of the gospel. And that truth will lead them out of places of captivity and into a place of spirit-filled freedom living. For 15 years now, Woman2Woman has been inspiring and encouraging women to grow closer to God and develop and nurture deeper relationships with Jesus through studying his word together, building relationships in an atmosphere of love and acceptance with a genuine sense of belonging. And for many of you ladies at home right now, I'm sure that's exactly how you felt when you've come along to Woman2Woman, loved, treasured, and a sense of belonging. Pastor Debbie is also a popular speaker at Christian women's conferences and events, and we are just delighted and excited that Debbie will be bringing the word this morning. We'll give you Pastor Debbie now. Welcome, Pastor Debbie Orr.
Hello, ladies, and welcome to this year's Woman2Woman Worship Day, Dare to Dream. It is so fantastic to be with you today. My name's Debbie Orr, and it is a joy to be bringing God's word to you at this morning's session. We are so delighted that this day is finally here. We are sad, though, not to be with you in person under one roof. However, we are gathered together today under one name. And that name is the name of Jesus. And his banner over us all today is love. So ladies, are you ready? Are you ready to dare to dream? If so, let's come before the Lord now in prayer. Father, we are so excited. We are so grateful that you have provided this space for us today to come together and to worship you. Father, you deserve all the honor and all the glory and all the praise. And we enter your courts with thanksgiving in our hearts today. Thank you, Jesus, for preparing this space for us. Thank you, Lord, that we are coming together, women from all different walks of life. But we are here for you. We are waiting here for you. And we invite your Holy Spirit now. And we ask that you would open the eyes of our hearts and our minds to your truths. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, as I prayed there, we are joined by ladies from all over, different churches, different age brackets, all from different walks of life, and it is a joy. Ladies, you are all wonderfully unique. The Bible says that you are fearfully and wonderfully made by the Father. Yes, he created you. His dream for you was to live with purpose. His purpose for your life. You were carefully selected and chosen by the Father. And I wonder if you know the dreams that he has placed inside of you. Well, today we're going to look at those dreams. We're going to see those dreams resurrected. For when you know the plans that God has for your life, you will see greater things. You will be the woman that you were created to be. You will do things that you never believed that you could do. You will see things that you could never have imagined. The Bible says that no eye has seen, what no ear has heard, and what no human mind has conceived, the things that God has prepared for those who love him. Do you love him today? 1 Corinthians 2, verse 9. This morning, we're going to look at those dreams. those dreams that God has for your life. And maybe you're watching this morning and you're thinking, I am living the dream. And if you are, then hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Take this time today to worship Him and to thank Him. We've already been blessed this morning with the worship here at Moss Vale, led by Peter Chalk. However, I believe that there are some women tuning in today, and that's not the case. You're not currently living the dream. That those dreams, those hopes have been dashed. Well, today we're going to see those dreams resurrected. Today we're going to watch as the Holy Spirit breathes new life into those dreams, into those hopes, and into those visions. God wants to ignite a fire, ladies, and a passion inside of each and every one of us today as you dare to dream, as you dare to dream big, as you dare to dream God-sized dreams for your life, God-inspired dreams for your life, as today's the day. It's time. The Bible says that in the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Young men will see visions. Old men will dream dreams. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy. Acts 2:17-18. Peter here at Pentecost was quoting the prophet Joel from the Old Testament, and he was talking about the power of the Holy Spirit working in and through our lives. This life-giving spirit that enables us, that empowers us to see, to dream dreams, to have hope, to have vision. Are you living with that power in your life? That Holy Spirit breathing power. You will receive the power of the Holy Spirit when you receive Jesus. Have you received Jesus as your Lord and Savior? Jesus is Lord. God created you to dream, to dare to dream. So let's pause for a moment just now, ladies, and let's take a little trip down memory lane. When you were a little girl, filled with sugar and spice and all things that were nice, what did you dream of? What did you dream of becoming? What was your childhood dream? You know, when we're young, we're free in our dreams. It's so liberating. It's so wonderful. You ask a child, what do you want to become when you grow up? They proclaim it with boldness. I want to be an international football player. I want to be a movie star without any hesitation. When we were young, we were so free to dream big. But we weren't even restricted. No, for instance, you weren't restricted by budget or location. You dreamed of living in palaces that you could never afford today. We planned lavish weddings in our minds that we could never afford today. We traveled all around the world and back again, didn't we, in our dreams? And today you might not even be able to afford a passport. You perhaps dreamed of becoming the first female president of the United States of America when you're British, living in the west of Scotland. We believed that we could do anything and everything, that we had the ability, that we had the talent, we had the confidence, we had the power to live out our dreams. And it was a hopeful, innocent time in our lives when we were filled with sugar and spice and dreams. We had so much optimism. We had so much ambition to be that doctor that saves lives, to be a teacher that inspires a generation, to be that passionate evangelist that leads many to Jesus. We believed it. We believed it then. We didn't stop for a minute when we were dancing around the living room, dreaming that one day we would become a prima ballerina, never thinking that one day One day, this dream will be taken from me. One day, this hope will be gone. One day, I would wake up and I would no longer dream, that my dreams would be shattered, that one day we would wake up one morning ashamed because we went to bed with a frog, hoping that he would turn out to be a prince. But he didn't. So before we go any further, I wonder, what was your dream? Perhaps your dream walked out the door on you, abandoned you, let you down. At what point in your life did you, dear one, stop dreaming? At what point did you give up on that dream and that dream died inside of you? Was it for a dream job? Was it for a dream husband? Did you dream that you would have a family and that you would walk through a park pushing a pram? Was your dream to do something fantastic in ministry for Jesus? What was your dream? What was that dream inside of you that is now gone? Now, ladies, I'm not here to tell you why your dreams did not come true. I'm also not here today to tell you that all your dreams are going to come true. No, I'm not. That would be foolish and naive of me. However, what I am here to share with you today is that God has a dream for you. It is a God-sized, God-hoped, God-inspired dream for your life. And today is the day that you dare to dream for that dream, for God's dream for your life. And let me encourage you this morning that God the Father created you to dream. Yes, he did. He created us to dream. God gave us hearts and minds where dreams are birthed, where dreams are conceived. God designed us to dream because God is a dreamer. He dreamed up you and I. He created us in his imagination and he brought us, he breathed us into life. Psalm 139, beautiful psalm. I'm going to read to you 13 to 18 now. For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place, when I was woven together in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. God's dream for you. How precious to me are your thoughts, O God. How vast is the sum of them. Were I to count them, they would outnumber the grains of sand. When I awake, I am still with you. Amen. God created you, every part of you, and he created you to live with purpose. He created you to step into the plans that he has for your life. And let me tell you, God has great plans for your life. The Bible tells us that. Jeremiah chapter 29:11, very famous verse of scripture. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you, not to harm you, plans to give you hope, and plans to give you a future. However, in order to step into the plans and the purposes in which God has for our lives, we need to seek him. We need to seek his face. We need to seek God with all of our heart. If we read on in chapter 29, verse 13, it says in Jeremiah that you will seek me and find me when you seek me with all of your heart. Are you seeking God today with all of your heart? Did you come around your computer screen today with that in mind, to seek God today for your life? If that's true for you today, then the Bible says that when you seek him with all of your heart, you will find him. You will find him today. Ladies, it's time now. It's time to dare to dream. We will know what those dreams are for our lives when we seek his face. It's time to dream again. And it doesn't matter how many of your dreams have not come to pass to date. It doesn't matter how old you think you are. It doesn't matter. C.S. Lewis said, you're never too old. You're never too old to set another goal or to dream a new dream. It's not too late for you. It's time to dream big. Yes, I said it. Dream big. However, if you're going to dream big, then you're going to need faith. Notice I didn't say big faith. No, because faith as small as a mustard seed can move mountains. That's what the Bible says. So today God is calling us to have faith, to dream dreams, and to step into the plans and the purposes that God has for your life. It's not too late. You're not too old. You're not too young. You're not beyond his reach. It doesn't matter how many of your plans have not come to reality yet. It's not too late to dream God's dream for your life. Let our eyes be enlightened this day, to see the dreams that God has in store for us. This is my prayer. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he has called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance in his holy people, Ephesians 1, verse 18. And we believe that the God who created us to dream will bring those dreams into reality. Do you believe that he can? Let's look at Ephesians 3:20 in the Message. It says that God can do anything. Hallelujah. You know far more than you could ever imagine, far more than you could ever guess or request in your wildest dreams. He does it not by pushing us around, but by working within us, by his Spirit, deeply and gently within us. Today, God speaks dreams over your life, and what he has spoken, no one can take away from you. No one. Just look at the man that we're about to study in this morning's session. You know, we can't have a conference about dreams without mentioning or talking about the most famous dreamer that we know, Joseph. God spoke Joseph into being. God created him. And he spoke dreams into Joseph's heart. He had a mighty plan for this young man's life. He was called. He was ordained by God. God had designs for this young man's life. And as we shall hear today, there were many dream snatchers. Yes, dream snatchers. There were many dream snatchers who tried to rob and steal and destroy the dream that God had placed inside of him. It was God's dream for this man to live with favor, that he would be elevated to a place of authority and service for God. However, not everyone saw it. Not everyone believed it. Not everyone believed in the dream that God had given to Joseph. Ladies, the dream that God has for your life, not everyone is going to welcome it. Not everyone is going to understand it. Not everyone will support it. We read of this young man, enthusiastic, handsome, 17 years old, in the book of Genesis, chapter 37. Turn with me now. Jacob lived in the land where his father had stayed, the land of Canaan. This is the account of Jacob's family line. Joseph, a young man of 17, was tending the flocks with his brothers, the son of Bilhah and the sons of Zilpah, his father's wives, and he brought their father a bad report about them. Joseph basically snitched on his brothers at this point. Now Israel, also Jacob, loved Joseph more than any of his other sons because he had been born to him in his old age, and he made an ornate robe for him. When his brothers saw that the father loved him more than any of them, they hated him and could not speak a kind word to him. Joseph had a dream, and when he told it to his brothers, they hated him all the more. He said to them, "Listen to the dream I had. We were binding sheaves of grain out in the field when suddenly my sheaf rose and stood upright, while your sheaves gathered around mine and bowed down to it. His brothers said to him, do you intend to reign over us? Will you actually rule us? And they hated him all the more because of the dream and what he had said. Then he had another dream, and he told it to his brothers. Listen, he said, I had another dream, and this time the sun, the moon, and the 11 stars were bowing down to me. When he told his father, as well as his brothers, his father rebuked him and said, what is this dream you had? Will your mother and I and your brothers actually come and bow down the ground before you? His brothers were jealous of him, but his father kept the matter in mind. He pondered it in his heart. So we read there that Joseph was set apart from his brothers from an early age, from a young age. And you know this story well. If you haven't read it in the Bible, you may have seen it in the theater. Jacob, his father, had blessed Joseph with this beautiful robe of nobility and of honor. Now, he wasn't the eldest son. So why was Jacob honoring Joseph in this way? Why was he blessing Joseph over the others? Well, this is what we like to call, or we would call, a bit of a dysfunctional family, if you like. There were all sorts of things going on in this family, like any other family, really. Jacob, years before, had worked for his uncle. His name was Laban. And he believed that after his time served working for Laban, that Laban would present his daughter, Rachel, to Jacob as his wife, because Jacob was in love with Rachel. Uncle Laban tricked Jacob, though, and on the wedding night, he gave him his eldest daughter, Leah, instead. Then the years of distress and jealousy and bitterness between the two sisters began. Jacob worked a further 7 years in order to get Rachel, the one that he loved. Leah knew that Jacob loved her sister more than her, and this caused her deep pain. However, Leah was in actual fact able to provide Jacob with 6 sons and a daughter, whereas Rachel, she struggled. She struggled to conceive. However, when she finally conceived, she gave birth to a son and she named him Joseph. It says there in verse 4 that the brothers hated him. He hated him because Jacob had shown favor to the son of the woman that he loved the most. But how very sad. Young Joseph looking up to his big brothers, wanting them to accept him. And it says that they spoke horribly to him. They didn't have a good word to say about him. And perhaps you know what that feels like, to be treated unfairly, that no one within your family perhaps values you. Perhaps all your life you've felt like the odd one out, that you've been cast aside. But let me encourage you of something today, dear sister. You have not been cast aside. No. In actual fact, you have been set apart by God for his purpose for your life. We were called as God's daughters to come away from this world, this life, and be separate. Ladies, Joseph was set apart from the very beginning. Not only had God planted dreams inside of Joseph, but he also showed him the future, the plans for the future. We read about it there, about the sheaves of grain being taller than the other ones. Then in verse 9, the dream about the sun and the moon and the 11 stars bowing down to Joseph. God was showing Joseph this place of honor, this place of authority that he was going to elevate him to above his brothers. Now, I'm not sure what possessed Joseph to share this dream with his brothers, but he did. The brothers that didn't speak a kind word to him, but he chose to share it with them. Perhaps he thought that maybe they would respect him. Maybe they would know that if he was called by God, that he was special, that they would maybe love him and treat him better. But it didn't change a thing. Not for Joseph. His brothers were still angry with him. They were still jealous with him. I said earlier, not everyone is going to welcome the plans that God has for your life, the call that God has upon your life. But Joseph, well, he chose to share it with his brothers, naively perhaps, and they became the first lot of dream snatchers that we're going to see today in Joseph's life. The brothers were not happy. Neither was Jacob, Joseph's father. He rebuked Jacob. Rather than being supportive and encouraging of God's dream for his life, it only made them more jealous and even more angrier with Joseph. Ladies, not everyone is going to be on board with your dreams. Not everyone is going to understand the call that God has for your life. Therefore, you must guard and protect those dreams, for they are precious. They are from God. And as a set-apart daughter of the Most High King, there are times you're going to have to stand tall and you're going to need to come apart from this world because you are set apart. And do you know who else you need to protect your dreams from? Satan. Yes, he is working hard to steal and kill your dreams. He is the ultimate dream snatcher. He wants to capture your dreams. He wants to kill your dreams. He wants to trick you into thinking that you're not good enough. You're not good enough. God has no dreams for you, or that God's dreams are never going to come to reality for you. You're not worthy enough, that God has forgotten about you. Satan does this on purpose. His strategy is to get you to the point where you give in, you give up, you stop believing, you stop dreaming. And if he is convincing enough, then job done for Satan, because the dreamer then stops dreaming. The dreamer stops believing. And that's why some of you ladies today have stopped dreaming, because the enemy has stolen those dreams from your heart, that hope has been taken from you. But today, ladies, today is the day where you dare to dream again. So be mindful. Be mindful who you share your dreams with. That dream for a period of time may just be for you. It may just be for you to know about, for you to ponder, and for you to pray into. A dream is much like the terms of a pregnancy, the gestations of a pregnancy. There's that point where that dream is conceived in that secret place. And for a time, it's only you that knows it's in there, in your heart. And that's the time for you to ponder it. It's the time for you to press in and to seek his face and to pray into it, which we'll hear later on today. And then comes the time where that dream is ready to be birthed. And it doesn't stop there, for once that dream is birthed, you have to nurture it. You have to care for it. So the dream that God has birthed inside of you, if and when you decide to share it, can I encourage you not to be naive like Joseph? Don't share it with those that are not going to support you. Instead, share it with someone you trust. Share it with someone who is like-minded. Share it with someone who also believes in God-sized dreams. Share it with another dreamer. You know, over the years, I've had an immense privilege of working alongside other women, and women have come to me with those dreams and those visions that God has placed in their hearts. And as I've said, it's a massive privilege for me to be able to draw alongside them, for I too am a dreamer, and be able to pray with them and pray into those dreams with them, and then see their dreams turn into a reality. So let's be dreamers who dare to dream with others, who will support and encourage our sisters in Christ. And let's not be filled with jealousy, and let's not be filled with bitterness like Joseph's brothers were. Instead, let's be the kind of women that celebrate other people's achievements and dreams. Let's encourage others. Let's celebrate each other's dreams today. Sadly for Joseph, God's plan and purpose for his life was not safe in the hands of his brothers. It was not. We read that they were jealous. We read that they hated him. And this led, this jealousy, this bitterness, this anger, this envy, it led to sin. It led to a devastating act, we read that the brothers continue to mock Joseph. And seeing Joseph, verse 19, they say, here comes the dreamer. They mocked him. They didn't get it. They said to each other, verse 20, come now, let's kill him. Throw him into one of these cisterns and say that a ferocious animal devoured him. Then we'll see what comes of his dreams. His own brothers planned to kill him and kill the dream inside of him. It's only through a change of plan by one of the brothers that they decide to sell Joseph instead into slavery as opposed to murdering him. Then the Midianites merchants, they take him. They take him to Egypt and they sell him to Potiphar, the Pharaoh's official, the captain of the guard. So perhaps you're hearing this story for the first time and you're thinking, well, that's it. The dream is over for Joseph now. But here's the thing. It was God's dream for Joseph. That makes all the difference, as God can be trusted to keep his promise. That's a word for someone today. God can be trusted to keep his promise. If you know this story well, you know that Joe's trials and tribulations didn't stop there. The dream snatchers, they kept coming at Joseph, all in an attempt to steal and kill the dream that God had placed inside of him. And at every single stage of his life, we see God's hand of favor upon Joseph's life. Ladies, you will face opposition to your dreams. You will. God, those dreams that God has inspired and placed inside of you. And it's our objective, ladies, not to give up. Not to give up on those dreams. Not to give up on those dreams that God has placed inside of us. I know it's hard at times. I know it's difficult at times. It was difficult for Joseph. I mean, just look at his life. It's hard to imagine how this young man, he was only a young man. It's hard to imagine how he kept the faith. This young man was sold into slavery. He was separated from his father, who he loved, from his family. He was abandoned by his brothers, thrown into the pit. He was left in darkness. He was lonely, and he was isolated. Can you imagine the battle that would have gone on in his mind? The thoughts that must have been running through his head. I'm unloved. I'm unwanted. I'm no good. They didn't want me. They didn't believe me. They didn't believe in me. They didn't believe in the word that God had placed in me. They didn't believe that I was called. Perhaps you know what that feels like. Perhaps that's exactly how you feel. Joseph had nothing. All he had was a dream. All that he had was the dream that God gave him, and boy, was he tested to give that dream up. We read of Joseph moving out of the pit and now into the palace because he finds favor with Potiphar. We read in chapter 39 now that the Lord was with Joseph so that he prospered and he lived in the house of his Egyptian master. Verse 3, when his master saw that the Lord was with him and that the Lord gave him success in everything he did, Joseph found favor in his eyes and became his attendant. Potiphar put him in charge of the household and he entrusted to his care everything that he owned. From this time, he put him in charge of his household and of all that he owned. The Lord blessed the household of the Egyptian because of Joseph. The blessing of the Lord was on everything that Potiphar had, both in the house and in the field. So Potiphar left everything he had in Joseph's care. With Joseph in charge, he did not concern himself with anything except the food that they ate. Wow, that's the hand of God. We read there that the Lord was with Joseph, and Joseph was a blessing to many. Just look at how he blessed this household. Just look at how much respect Potiphar had for Joseph. But yet again, ladies, yet again, the enemy was prowling around looking to devour Joseph's dream. This time, the dream snatcher was Potiphar's wife. You see, Satan had already tried throwing him into the pit, isolation, seclusion, abandonment. But this time, he was using seduction. This time, the dream snatcher was in the form of a beautiful woman, Potiphar's wife, and she tempted Joseph. She tempted him to sleep with her. The enemy had tried everything, so now he was trying seduction. What are we going to do here? What are we looking at here? This is sin. This is sin. Ladies, giving in to sin will lead you away from the plans and the purposes that God has for your life. Now, I'm not going to say today that you're not going to be tempted, because you will be tempted. We're all tempted at times. Let's be honest. The things that usually tempt us, they're usually quite appealing. We're never tempted by things that are ugly or grotesque. No, it's things that the flesh responds to. We want, we desire, we allure after. For Joseph, it's Potiphar's wife here. She's standing in front of him. She's beautiful. She's seducing him. However, ladies, once we take a bite from that apple from the forbidden tree, then Satan's plan has come to pass. That's his strategy, to get us to give in to sin, to watch us fall and then snatch our dreams from our hearts. Nothing's changed from the beginning of time. He used the same strategy and tactic with Adam and Eve, and he led them into sin. But the good news today, ladies, the great news today, ladies, is there is power over sin. And Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, he made sure of that. He made a way for us for that on the cross. The temptations in your life are no different from what others experience. And God is faithful. He will not allow the temptation to be more than you can stand. When you are tempted, he will show you a way out so that you can endure. 1 Corinthians 10, verse 13. You know, this verse of scripture is misquoted so often. People quote it and say, God won't allow you to suffer any more than you can endure. But that's not actually what it's talking about here. It's talking about temptation. It says that God will not allow you to be tempted any more than you can stand. But when you are tempted, God will lead you out. He will give you a way out. It's up to you whether you take that way out. But he will present you, show you a way out so that you can endure it. And ladies, that's what happens here. There was a way out for Joseph. He ran out. He ran away from Potiphar's wife. He knew in his heart that the dream that God had placed inside of him was greater than what this woman was offering. Sometimes you've got to take a moment and think about that. Sometimes you've got to pause and think about that. That what God is offering you is far greater than what this world is offering you right now or will ever offer you now and forever more. Sometimes we need to sacrifice the immediate for the ultimate and not give in. And Joseph recognized that and he fled this situation. Now, you're probably thinking, but didn't he end up in jail because of this? He said no to Potiphar's wife and he still landed in jail. And you're right, he did. Because Potiphar's wife lied about him. This dream snatcher lied about him. She accused him of raping her. She lied. And it led to Joseph being in prison. But it's not the first time. It's not the first time that we read about Joseph alone and isolated and locked up. No, he's already been in a pit. Joseph knew that he wasn't alone. Joseph had a dream. Joseph had a dream inside of him, a dream that God placed inside of him. He may not have had anything else, but he had that dream. What word has God spoken into your life? What dream has God breathed into your life? It is time to revisit it today. To resurrect it, to believe in it. You may think you have nothing. You may find yourself today in a place like Joseph, lonely place, in captivity. But can I encourage you to start to dream, to start to believe again? It's not too late, and it wasn't too late for Joseph either. Even in prison, Joseph found favor, this time with the prison warden. Joseph, by this point, he's gone from the pasture of his father's field to the pit, to the palace, to the prison. But ladies, he stayed true to himself and the calling that God had given him. He stayed true to the dream that God had given him, and he did not remain silent. Yes, it was talking about his dreams that landed him in trouble. It was talking about his dreams with his brothers that caused a catalogue of bad things to happen, because there are dream snatchers who will come against you, just like they came against Joseph. But he wasn't going to give up on that gift. He wasn't going to give up on that dream. He wasn't going to remain silent. In fact, it was speaking out about his dreams that finally led him out of captivity, out of imprisonment. When we speak out our dreams at the right time to the right people, we read in chapter 40 now of Joseph interpreting the dreams that the king had, the king's cupbearer and baker, who were being held in prison. It is Joseph that makes a way for the cupbearer to be freed. Then in chapter 41, and you can read this all in your own time, we read of Pharaoh battling with his dreams. And he calls for everyone and anyone to try and interpret them, but no one can help him. But it just so happens that this cupbearer who once encountered Joseph, in that moment he remembered. He's like, I remember this guy when I was thrown in prison, when I was facing death. I remember this guy. And actually, do you know what? He interprets dreams. In fact, he interpreted a dream that actually freed me. So in chapter 41, we read, then the chief cupbearer said to Pharaoh, today I'm reminded of my shortcomings. You see, this cupbearer forgot all about Joseph. He forgot all about what Joseph had done for him. But do you know who hadn't forgotten about Joseph? And more importantly, who hadn't forgotten about the dream inside of Joseph? God. Because it was God's dream. And this was Joseph's moment. He had a shower, he had a shave, and he's presented before Pharaoh. And he accurately and he confidently interprets Pharaoh's dreams. The dream about the 7 good years of harvest and the dreams about the years of famine. And this greatly aids Pharaoh. It gives him great wisdom and it saves many lives. If ever was the right time to share your dream, it was now. The right person was listening this time. You know, when Pharaoh asks Joseph to interpret the dream, do you know what he says? Verse 16, I'll read it to you now. I cannot do it, Joseph replied to Pharaoh, but God will give Pharaoh the answer that he desires. Joseph, in that moment, could have elevated himself, but he didn't. He could have made the dream happen. He could have made the dream become a reality in that moment for himself if he'd have taken the credit, but he didn't. He didn't do that. And ladies, we need to do the same. Let's be set apart daughters of the Most High King that promote Jesus in our lives, that we would showcase Jesus, that it would be about Christ's promotion and not self-promotion. Joseph knew that his gift, his dream, was from God. He says it again, verse 25, God has revealed to Pharaoh what he is about to do. It's God's dream. It's God's dream. Joseph was humble. He'd been given the opportunity by God. He stood strong. He didn't give up on the dream. And he honored God in the process. Ladies, this led to Joseph's promotion. He was elevated, just as his original dream foretold. Just as he shared with his brothers, he was promoted to the position of prime minister. There was no higher role for Joseph. This is what Pharaoh said about Joseph at the time. So Pharaoh asked him, can we find anyone like this man, one in whom the Spirit of God lives? The Pharaoh said to Joseph, since God has made all this known to you, there is no one so discerning and wise as you. You shall be in charge of my palace, and all of my people are to submit to your orders. Only with respect to the throne will I be greater than you. Wow. And again, it was this position that the Lord not only brought to fruition, the dreams inside of Joseph, but we also see in chapters 42 to 47, you can read it in your own time, that his relationship with his brothers and his family are restored, completely restored. And you know how the story ends. Joseph's brothers do bow down to him. They do honor him and have respect for Joseph in the end. And there's some lovely moments in those chapters, in those passages that reveal the process and the power of restoration in relationships. You can read it in your own time. It's wonderful how this family is restored in the end. Joseph showed incredible faith and trust in God. He knew that God placed that dream inside of his heart. He knew it was from God. It was God's dream. It was a God-sized dream. That's why it was so big for others to understand. Even faced with trial after trial after trial, he had nothing, but he had his dream, and he held on to it. Every stage of his life, we've seen today the enemy, the dream snatchers attempting to kill the dream. His own brothers attempted to kill the dream. He was abandoned. He was rejected by the ones that he so dearly loved. He gave up his coat of nobility. He gave up his coat of honor, but he did not give up on his dream. He may have lost that coat of many colors, but the dream was still inside of him. And our Lord Jesus Christ, he gave up more than a coat of honor. He gave up his life. He gave up his life, but he did not give up in his dream. And that was to seek and to save the lost. That's you and that's me today. Praise God. So as we come to the end of Joseph's story, we read these wonderful words in chapter 50. This is following the death of their father, Jacob. Joseph said to them, "Don't be afraid. I am in the place of God. You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good, to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives. So then don't be afraid. I will provide for you and your children." And he reassured them and he spoke kindly to them. Wow. All those years that they did not speak kind to him. And he reassured them and he spoke kindly to them. And to you today, in your life, the enemy have attempted to steal your dreams. You may think those dreams are dead, but let me encourage you of something today. What the enemy meant to harm you, God can turn it around for your good. So dare to dream today. Dare to dream God-sized dreams for your life today. What dream has God given you? Why did you give up on it? Who was it that took that dream from you? Was it fear and inadequacy? You know, fear of failure often prevents us from stepping out and stepping into the plans that God's got for our lives. What if I fail? But you know what? Sometimes our dreams do fail. They do. But don't allow that to prevent you from getting up again. Just look at Joseph. How many times did he get up? How many times did he get back up? Get up, dare to dream. At the other side of that, fear is your purpose. So don't allow fear to snatch God's dreams from your heart. So as we're nearing now the end of our morning session, do you believe that God has a dream for your life? Perhaps you do believe. Perhaps you've heard this story today from Joseph's life. Perhaps you've heard these words today and you do believe. You do believe that God has placed a dream in your life, but you're just not sure. Is the dream that's in my heart right now, is it the will of God? Is this dream a God dream? I know, ladies, it's not always easy. It's not always easy to know the will of God. However, God has made a way for us. He has made a way for us. We need to persistently seek his face, to seek the plans that he has for our lives. Matthew 6:33 in the NLT, as Jesus said, "Seek the kingdom of God above all else and live righteously, and he will give you everything that you need." So I want to leave you this morning as we come to the end of our morning session with three simple steps to knowing, is this dream a God dream? So number one is this. Is this a God dream? Then bring it to the Lord in prayer and ask. Yes, just ask him. God, is this dream from you? If it's not, take this dream from my heart. I don't want this dream if it's not your dream. Ask God to align your dreams with his dreams for your life. Ask him. Matthew 7, verse 7 and 8 says, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be open to you. For everyone who asks receives. The one who seeks will find, and to the one of who knocks, the door will be opened. So simply ask God, is this dream from you, O Lord? The second part of that verse in Matthew says that once we have asked, we have to seek. Seek God. How do we do that? Well, that's point two. We are to get into the Word. Ask the question, does this line up with God's Word? Does this dream in my heart line up with Scripture? Does it line up with God's Word? Does it reflect God's character? Does it reflect God's heart, his nature, his desires? You will know the answer to those questions when you know his Word, when you get into his Word, because his Word reveals his character. His Word reveals his nature. His Word also reveals the plans and the desires and the hopes that he has for you as his child. So once you've asked in prayer, you then seek by searching his Word. And the third step is to knock. The third point is to act in obedience. Number three, we step out in obedience. We knock on the doors of opportunity that God presents before us. It's time to step out in obedience. Sometimes you've just got to step out in faith. Sometimes you've just got to make the call. Sometimes you've just got to make the decision. Start the plan. Take the first step. Share it with someone that you can trust, who will pray with you, who will lead you, who will guide you, who will offer you godly counsel. That's how Woman2Woman was born. It was born out of a dream that God gave to me. And after going through this very simple three-step process of seeking his face, of praying into it, of lining it up with Scripture, it was time for me just to step into it. Just to start it up. And ladies, this ministry was birthed 15 years ago and we are still living the dream at Woman2Woman today. We are still dreaming big for this ministry and for all who come around it. The fact that we're all here today is a dream that has come to fruition because we dared to dream. We dared to believe that even in a pandemic, that we would be able to still come together for our worship day. And God has a dream for your life too. It's not just for me. It's not just for Woman2Woman. It's not just for pastors and elders and leaders. No, it's for you today. Ladies, when God has placed this dream in your heart, he will not take that dream away. But you need to dare to believe in that dream, that God-sized, God-inspired dream that he's placed inside of you. You know, when we began to pray into this dream, the dream that we would come together today in this way, online through this church platform, you know, God gave us a picture for this worship day of a bunch of balloons. You were wondering when I was going to make mention of these beautiful, stunning balloons. Well, God gave us as a ministry this picture. And he showed us these balloons, all different shapes and sizes and colors, but each one representing your dreams. Your dreams, the dreams that have perhaps died inside of you. And today's the day that these dreams are resurrected. The Lord also revealed to us that these dreams were being held down by a weight. He showed us the picture of the weights that you see on balloons that hold them down at parties on tables. However, the thing is, the truth is, your dreams were never made to be held down. No, your dreams were made to fly and soar. And it's time today for those weights to be cut off and your dreams to take flight, to be free, to soar, to fly. And you know what, ladies? We have the most perfect cutting implement, and it is the sword of the Spirit, which is God's word, and we take God's word in hand. And the Bible tells us that it is sharper than any two-edged sword. And we come against the enemy today who is seeking to rob, steal, and kill our dreams. And we cut through the lies that the world has spoken over us. We cut through that heavy weight. We cut it off now in the name of Jesus, that which has bound us. And we pray, Jesus, breathe new life into our dreams today. Allow the Holy Spirit right now just to breathe fresh life, fresh air back into your dreams so that your dreams can take flight today. So inside your conference pack, you will find a balloon that we prayed over and we carefully placed inside of that pack for you. And what I'd like you to do is take that balloon out. Take it now in your hand. That balloon represents your dream that has died inside of you. And I want you to look at that balloon and look at the dream that God has placed inside of you. I want to visualize today God breathing life back into that balloon. So as you blow that balloon up, Jesus is breathing new life today back into your dreams, bringing you fresh hope today. For God created you, dear one, to dream. You are the result of his dream that he carefully chose and selected you. He designed you to dream his dreams for your life, his purposes, his plans, his hopes for your life. So ladies, it's time to dare to dream. And I want to close with the words from Paul that we read earlier from Ephesians 3:20 and 21 in the message. It says, God can do anything. Do you believe it? Do you believe that God can breathe fresh life into your dreams today? It's far more he can do, more than you could ever imagine, more than you could ever guess, more than your wildest dreams. He doesn't do it by pushing you around, but by working within us. He's working within you right now by the power of his Spirit, deeply and gently within us. Glory to God in the church. Glory to God in the Messiah in Jesus. Glory down all the generations. Glory through the millennia. Oh yes, glory to God. So are you ready? Are you ready to see those dreams resurrected in Jesus' name? Then I invite you now to take your moment with Jesus. Right now, to respond to Jesus. This is your moment. I can't be with you in person, but Jesus is with you. So take your moment now to respond to Jesus. If God has spoken to you this morning and you want to see Jesus breathe fresh hope, life, vision and dreams into your life, then you might want to stand right now, or you might want to drop to your knees. Respond to God how your heart wants to respond right now as we pray. Let's pray. Lord, we come before you now. We believe that you are the master craftsman, that you created each and every one of us. And we thank you, O God, that we are fearfully and wonderfully made by your hand, that we are a result of your dreams. Father, we have heard that you have great plans for our lives, plans that you've already prepared for us, Lord. And we want to step into those plans. We want to see the future, oh God, that you've got for our lives. We declare today that the enemy will no longer have a hold over our God-ordained dreams. Today we release the pain. Today we release the pain of shattered dreams into your hands. And we ask for healing this day. And we ask for strength this day to dream again. Yes, Lord, we pray that you would open the eyes of our hearts, that they would be enlightened so that we would know the hope to which you've called us. Lord, we receive your dreams for our lives right now. We release our hearts, our minds, our bodies, our souls into your hands, and we pray your plans for our lives as we dare to believe, as we dare to dream today, God-sized dreams, in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Ladies, it's been such a joy, an answer to my dreams, to be able to be with you today in your homes, worshiping God together. We are so grateful to God that you dared to dream by being here today. And I pray that you will be richly blessed by this conference today, this worship day today. I'm going to hand you now back to Peter and the Mossvale Community Church Praise Band as we come together and we worship and we thank Jesus for all that he has done for us in our lives. Let's worship God together now. Amen.
You are
thank you so much to Pastor Debbie for our wonderful, inspiring words this morning. And thank you also to our fabulous Mossvale worship team for leading us so beautifully in praise this morning. So that brings our first half of our worship day to a close. It's now time to break for lunch, and we'll be back shortly for this afternoon's session. But don't log off completely, girls, as we have a PowerPoint presentation that's going to be running through the break with information about our chosen charity this year, the Rescue Aid Mission in Ghana. Can I remind you of our prayer support sessions also, ladies, number to text. If you need prayer, remember to leave your name and we will get back to you. The gorgeous wee star that is Mary Stewart will be leading us through this afternoon's session, girls. For now, it's goodbye from me. And we all just cannot wait to see you all very, very soon at the Woman2Woman sessions on Thursday evenings and Friday mornings. Please continue to check the social media platforms for all the information you need. It's just time for me now to close up in prayer. Let's just pray. So, Lord, we do just thank you for all we've heard this morning, Lord. We thank you for the praise and worship and the word, Lord. You are good all the time, Lord Jesus. We thank you for dreams. We thank you for the power of dreams, and we thank you for your love, Lord Jesus. We just pray ahead of time for this afternoon. We pray that it'll be a wonderful, spirit-filled time that we can all share together, Lord Jesus. In your holy name, we pray and thank you for all you do, Lord. Amen and amen. Right, ladies, go and have your lunch, powder your nose, and we'll come back and see you shortly. God bless.